I'm Amanda Olson from IntimateRose.com, and I'm a physical therapist specializing in pelvic floor rehabilitation. And this is part two of a three-part series on the pelvic floor. In the first video, we covered what the pelvic floor is, some anatomy, and the general structures associated with the pelvic floor. And today we're going to talk about different injuries and different activities that can result in pelvic floor weakness that lead to things like incontinence and low back pain, hip pain. So to review, we're looking at the pelvis here, and we've got the bony structures in white. Coming at the top view, the organs associated with the pelvic floor are the bladder, the uterus, and the rectum, and then the pelvic floor itself, which is comprised of the superficial layer, and again, everything that you see here in red, so the superficial layer here and the deep layer right behind it, and they are joined by a layer of fascia. So looking at it from the top view, the pelvic floor in through there. So the most common injury and activity that can lead to pelvic floor weakness is pregnancy and childbirth. So when you're considering that the weight over the top of the pelvic floor increases significantly for 9 months during pregnancy, the uterus places a lot of pressure onto that pelvic floor. So there's the uterus there. It grows up and out of the bowl of the pelvis, and that prolonged carrying time of that increased weight can lead to stretching and weakening of the pelvic floor muscles. Delivery of that baby, especially if it's vaginally, can lead to stretching and tearing of the pelvic floor as well. And even having a C-section, so even if it was a planned C-section, or perhaps the person went into labor and ended up with the C-section later, having that C-section scar that lives right here can put pressure onto the bladder and the structures lying right over the top of the pelvic floor, and that can lead to stretching and weakening of the pelvic floor muscles as well. The next thing that can lead to pelvic floor weakness is chronic constipation. So last video we discussed how the organs sit in the pelvic bowl here, and they are very tight neighbors. So they share close quarters, and the only thing separating them is a thin piece of fascia, which is just a thin piece of tissue that covers the organs and protects them. So they sit in the pelvic bowl like this, and with chronic constipation, the rectum is full for a prolonged period, and especially with chronic constipation, if it's happening over years, that fullness, that pressure of that bowel being full over time puts pressure on the pelvic floor here. So you can see the rectum coming down, and the pelvic floor can become weak as a result of that. So managing your constipation by visiting a physician or seeing a pelvic floor physical therapist is helpful, and then following that, strengthening the pelvic floor muscles. The next thing that we've been seeing a lot more in the past few years is pelvic floor weakness and damage related to heavy lifting. And so in females that are lifting heavy things, whether it's at work or as part of a fitness regimen, if the lifting is happening while there's breath holding, so holding their breath, that puts pressure on the pelvic floor. And the reason why is because the thorax, so the area between the pelvis and the rib cage, is like a soda can. And the soda can has high pressure, and when you pop the top off of it, it releases air. And the thorax functions similarly, whereas the pelvic floor is the bottom and the diaphragm is the top of that soda can. When we breathe, when we exhale, that releases the pressure in that thorax. So if you are lifting something heavy and holding your breath, that pressure stays in the thorax and puts all of that force down into the organs and finally through the pelvic floor itself. So there's been some videos of females actually leaking urine during lifting. And that's not normal. It happens, it's common, but it's not normal and it's very preventable. And the number one way to do that is first to be sure to exhale during a lift of anything heavy. And the second is to contract the pelvic floor during that lift, aside from using proper mechanics during the lift itself. And this is in particular the Olympic lifts like clean and jerks, deep squats, things like that. These are muscles just like everywhere else in the body. So it is possible to tear them. They have tendons. You can rupture those tendons by lifting forcefully in an improper way. The nice thing is, just like anywhere else in the body, rotator cuff, hamstring, they do mend over time, but you have to strengthen them properly and you have to then use them properly afterwards to prevent re-injury. So strengthening the pelvic floor is a key step in that rehabilitation process. The last activity that can lead to damage to the pelvic floor is a fall. And this is common in the winter. People slip and fall on ice, come down on their tailbone. Not only does it hurt the tailbone, but it can damage the pelvic floor muscles. And just reviewing from last time, we talked about the fact that the pelvic floor attaches onto the tailbone here and wraps around to the front. So you can see that during a fall onto that tailbone, accidents on a horse where there's pressure and force coming into the pubic bone and onto the pelvic floor there, slips and falls on ladders, trampolines, things like that, that blunt trauma can injure the muscles. And again, the nice thing is they do mend, and strengthening of the pelvic floor first by doing Kegels and then adding resistance with vaginal weights is a crucial part of that rehabilitation process. So that was part two of our three-part series. Be sure to visit intimaterose.com and look forward to the next video to come, where we're going to talk about what a Kegel is and how to do it properly and what different types of Kegels can be used for different purposes, and how the vaginal weights can help in that process.